Today on Dreamland, we're going to have John Alexander. He's been on Dreamland twice before, in 2011 and 2017. He's one of the world's great adventurers. You can find out all kinds of things about him on the internet and on his website, johnbalexander.com. It's a wonderful interview, and unlike anything you will have heard from John Alexander before, unfortunately, it's audio only because we were unable to successfully videotape it for reasons that are still fairly unclear. But that's Dreamland for you. We are not entirely alone in this mysterious place I call unknowncountry.com for a good reason. Next week, we're going to have a CIA officer on the show who has just recently been given permission to talk about something he worked on for years. And this show will be the first that he talks about it publicly. So be prepared for a big surprise next week. It is unusual, to say the least. Now, on Unknown Country, we're working on the Canary Islands volcano story because obviously the whole area is very unstable, and I think most of us are aware of the fact that if the huge cliff that is underwater off that island were to slide into the sea, it would create something along the lines of 100-foot tsunamis up and down the east coast of the United States, and even higher ones conceivably in Europe. So that's yet another accident waiting to happen. The volcano has erupted many times without that happening, and hopefully that will be the case again this time. But watch the site. We've also got a remarkable story this week that it seems that the story of Sodom from the Bible is true, in a sense. Not that God did it, but that apparently an asteroid or something hit the city years, thousands of years ago, and vaporized it. Archaeologists have found the site, and it's a fascinating story. Don't miss it. So do go to Unknown Country as often as you can. And if you're not a member of the site, well, join free as a free user, or better, subscribe and get the newsletter. It's free and it's every week and it keeps you up with everything we're doing. And that's a lot.
This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Today, we have returning to Dreamland a guest who's been on twice, and once in 2011 and once in 2017, who is one of the most interesting people in the world, in my humble opinion. John Alexander is back with us. He is the author of Reality Denied, UFOs, and a remarkable book about UFOs. We've interviewed John about both of them, and we will be returning to both areas during the course of this interview. John has been an advocate for including the paranormal and the seemingly impossible in our defense posture for a very long time. He has a PhD from Walden University, an MA from Pepperdine. He's attended the Anderson School of Management, might as well be magic. He has so many awards and so has accomplished so much, John. It's hard to know even how to describe you, except this is a genuinely remarkable man. So John Alexander, Dr. John Alexander, Colonel John Alexander, welcome to Dreamland. I should say welcome back to Dreamland.
Well, great to be here, Whitley. Hope you're doing well.
Well, I'm doing very well, thank you. I've had a surgery recently, but recovered from it. And I know you're knocking along, too. We're both getting up there. You're a little higher up than I am, I believe. But in any case, so much has happened since you wrote your book on UFOs. And I'm very eager to find out your thinking about this subject since the revelations that began in 2017 of the orchestrated by Leslie Keene and Ralph Blumenthal in the New York Times of the Navy Department videos that were released by Lou Alessandro. Your thinking is going to be fascinating. So can you let us know how you first reacted when you saw this happening?
Well, I'm not exactly sure where to go. I was not aware of the HF program, and yet I was not surprised by it. I think the guy who really gets credit for getting it out, while Lou was the kind of inside man, but Chris Mellon of the Mellon family was the one who had the connections and was able to influence the New York Times to publish the article. And as I say, the rest is sort of history. You know, it came forward to 25 June of this year when the DOD was required to submit a report to Congress about what they knew. And as I said, in my view, it A, did not surprise me, and B, was a huge nothing burger in particular.
So we're in a situation where I would think that there is still a great deal of information unreleased because they're showing material just from the United States Navy just from 2004 on, but there must be a lot more.
Well, there is a lot more. We're sure of that because we did know from the various pilots that primarily Navy, but they were having encounters on a near daily basis. That said, I think it is greatly misunderstood by the public in general. It's still my position that DOD is not terribly interested. This is a problem they would like to just go away and see the these reports and interference as a pain in the ass. I might say that my position is in a way very similar in that I don't see this as a government problem, though I see them having a role to play. But remember, these are international, they're seen globally around the world and have been seen for millennia. So it's not new, not a U.S. issue. It's much, much bigger than that. And just like, the Department of Defense has a considerable effort in healthcare, not only for people, but has done work that impacts other areas. That doesn't make them the lead in, health research.
Well, I understand that. Now, the question arose when the document that was released to the public, the 9-page document in June, which was, of course, to the public, extremely disappointing, it referred to it as a threat assessment. And I asked Chris Mellon what that meant, and he said, well, if we don't spin it that way, we're not going to get any interest from Congress, or his words to that effect. And I can see that. But is there a sense of threat that you're aware of anywhere within the military about this?
Well, I can play both sides of that. As you know, in the 1980s, I was running a program that was very similar to what has now been revealed from the more recent one, albeit without funding, and actually did the same thing, particularly when we finally tried to transition for money. Because you must remember, this is the Department of Defense. It is not the Department of Interesting Ideas. And so if you're going to do something within the government, I think this is sadly misunderstood, is it's got to be germane to the organization and the missions of that organization. So if you want money in the Department of Defense, you always build a threat. Having said that, we have a hugely bloated defense budget. If you remember back to the bad old days, with the Soviet Union, we were constantly describing the potential threat in the future as being almost insurmountable. Therefore, you needed more money. So if you're going to ask for dollars for defense, you've got to work that against some kind of threat.
And I wonder what that threat would be. And speaking from the standpoint of the close encounter community, obviously there's a threat, but there's an absolute refusal on the part of the people now in the public eye talking about this to even bring that subject up. For example, Lou Elizondo won't speak to me. He won't talk to me on the phone. He won't email with me. He will certainly not interview with me. And Chris Mellon said that in his wishes, it would be great if the abduction phenomenon never came up in the media at all, not now or in the future. And I don't understand quite what that means. I think that it... Go ahead.
I wouldn't understand that, and it's certainly not going to happen. Again, these are incidents that happen globally, some of them more and more spectacularly, particularly now as everything is instrumented. Cameras are every place and people seeing things and reporting them. From a press perspective, most of this is just items of interest. It isn't a spiller on slow news days.
On slow news days, yeah. So where do we stand with this then? Because there's a sort of relationship of some kind between the UFOs, or UAPs, I guess we now call them, unidentified aerial phenomena, because we're not sure what they are, even if they're material objects is not clear, frankly. And what seems to be coming out of them. And I just wonder if there actually is a relationship. I don't know. And
well,
go ahead.
Remember, as you well know, the whole phenomena has been constantly morphing and for centuries, and always staying a little bit ahead of the technology of the present day, but not the 1,000-year leap that people had talked about. It's not beyond your imagination, but it changes based on our belief system.
Well, if we assume that Ezekiel's wheel was some kind of what we would now call a UFO, although it's hard to know for certain, then it was at least 2,000 years ahead of his time. But then go ahead.
No, I was going to say, I usually start the presentations by, what do you mean by a UFO? And by that, I say, look, we got little balls of light and orbs that people talk about. We've got craft more than a mile across, hard craft picked up by sensor systems, and thousands of variations in between. So it gets very difficult to know, you know, this generic title of UFO, what specifically are we trying to address?
Well, exactly. But it comes down to the fact that we don't actually know what the craft are. I have in my possession the clearest piece of UFO video that exists in the private sector, as far as I've ever been able to tell. And it seems very clear that it is a structured object, and that it has a substantial field of some kind around it, because you can see disturbances in the air around the edges of it. And those disturbances are not uncommon in other videos that are less clear. But the thing is it something that's penetrating into our reality, or is it literally a ship that's here? If we were, you know, the old story of the two-dimensional reality, when a ball passes through it, the two-dimensional beings see a dot. It slowly turns into a long line and then declines into a dot again. They have no way of conceiving of a ball. How close are we to being in that situation with these objects, do you think?
Well, I think that's part of the problem. And the point is, the videos that you have, and there are a number that have now been seen, like the three released by DOD, that's only a tiny subset of the phenomena. So are we going to isolate? You know, many people have talked about the tic-tac, for example, and say, I can solve the physics of the tic-tac, and say, okay, but how does a tic-tac compare to an orb or something like that? But by the way, that might appear inside your house.
You know, yes.
You know, where these occur are equally of interest. As you may know, I come down against the ETH, your extraterrestrial hypothesis, not because incidents, such as yours, these interactions don't take place. I believe they do. But I think that, these are little gray guys from Zeta Reticuli. It's just a too simplistic answer to a very, very complex issue.
Well, free Dreamlanders, we're going to explore that complex issue, and I assure you, it's going to be in a completely new way in just a moment. Listen up.
Hi, this is Whitley. You know, the Afterlife Revolution is a funny book. It makes people happy, even though it's about the afterlife and thinking about crossing over. It made me happy to write it. And the reason it did was that I was actually in touch with Anne while I was writing it. And not only that, she proved it. She proved it clearly and completely. When you read the book, you'll see what I mean. You'll see why Dr. Gary Schwartz, who is one of the leading experts on the afterlife, considers it such an important book, why he wrote a foreword for it. Because this is about something real and incredible that we are told every day not to believe that we have souls and that we have an afterlife. Well, we do. We do. And the Afterlife Revolution is going to open the door for you, so you're not going to be thinking to yourself, maybe I don't, when you do. And that's why it's a book of joy. Go on Amazon, take a look at the great reviews, and get yourself a copy. It's available for your Kindle. It's available in paperback. And there's an audiobook read by me. And let me tell you something. You can hear something in my voice. People tell me that, and I think it's true. You know what it is? It's the inner joy that is part of me and has become part of me since this extraordinary thing happened. I have to say, And Strieber was a remarkable person in this life, and she still is. Get it today.
We're talking to Dr. John Alexander, a man of vast experience and knowledge in all kinds of areas, including many that are classified and secret, but who has an open mind when it comes to the paranormal and has had a lot of extraordinary experiences in this area and has advocated for it in all sorts of levels of government over the years. Now, just before we left the air, we talked just briefly about the idea that the alien contact situation is too simplistic. And I agree very much with you, John, as to that fact. But can you dimensionalize a little bit some ideas about what may actually be happening, assuming it, let's assume it isn't aliens. What else might it be?
Well, you know, one of my other major areas, in fact, my doctorate was under Elizabeth Kubler-Ross and has to do with death and dying and dealing with near-death experiences, which has now morphed into more on after-death communication. And I'm struck by, I'm currently reading the book that your book that you sent, Afterlife Revolution, which I would recommend to people. But it does address some of those complexities, because as you talk to Anne and have communication with her now, which is part of after-death communication, in there, you address some of these issues that say, you know, are we really dealing with alien, i.e. interplanetary entities of some kind, interdimensional ones, or are these consciousness issues? Because I firmly believe in the continuation of consciousness beyond physical death. So again, just trying to narrow it down, I see it just as constantly expanding as a rather than trying to narrow down the focus of these issues.
I wonder about this in this sense, because the first time we began to notice this connection between the visitors and the dead was at our cabin, when Anne began to arrange for groups to come up, and the dead would inevitably show up with or around the same time as what clearly looked to us like aliens. These gray beings, when you see them physically up close, are really, really odd looking. And my goodness. And to make the matter even stranger, the forest floor has a pungency to it, because it's basically a lot of rotted vegetative material. And they would smell like that when they came into the house, like they'd come up from below, not down from above. And I'm just curious about what you might make of all of this.
Yeah, well, I was struck by some of the wording in there, in your book, where you talked about a person from another species. And that asks several questions like, you know, what is a person? And how is that trans-species application? Because we don't talk about, you know, animals here on Earth as people, per se. And yet you're addressing entities such as that. And we have many, many cases of people who are talking about interacting with certainly sentient, non-human species of some sort. But I also point out that these have occurred throughout the entirety of human history and in all cultures.
Yeah, and they seem to be very much part of our lives. And yet, at the same time, at least I and a lot of people, I think, have a sense of something building somehow now. For example, there's even one person, Anjali Schultz, who has a long resume in the intelligence community. Not to say that that makes any difference in this case. I don't necessarily think it does, because it's not relevant to this type of thing. But she claims that she went into a cave in the Mojave Desert and met aliens, and they said to come back with a group of people whom they named, some of at least, she did not disclose who they were, and videotape them and then take the videotape out and show the world. And she's supposedly going to do this before the end of 2021. What if something like that happened? What would you then think that it might be going on? Just hypothetically. I'm not even suggesting it will happen. In fact, if you ask me what the odds are, I would think they're not very high. But still, it's a question worth asking.
Well, again, we have interactions between humans and sentient non-humans, and these seem to occur in many forms. If you take the issue of the psychomantium that Raymond Moody has sort of popularized now, and that is trying to have after-death communication, and that varies from mediumistic sorts of things, i.e. a sensing or knowing and passing of information, all the way up to physical interaction with some sorts of being, with a materialization.
Yes.
Albeit on a temporary basis. I'm kind of interested in orbs. You may know Chris Bledsoe.
Yes, I do know Chris.
Particularly interesting because you know that I had an experience with him that literally blew my mind when we were sitting in the field and he says, oh, I think they're here. And within just a few seconds, this object pops into view and goes zipping off. But now he, on a continuous basis, sends me pictures of orbs and believes that he's having communications with them. Similarly, Ray Hernandez, who has done a lot of work in this area as well, was down at his house, and he talks about, you know, a craft materializing inside the house, as well as ones that are outside. So you run into various issues, particularly when you're looking at it from a physical 3D, three-dimension kind of approach, which says, you know, these things just can't happen and don't happen within our realm of understanding. And I think we're extremely limited by the basic materialistic belief system that seems to, you know, be the foundation of Western beliefs.
Yeah, exactly. We're living inside a belief system that is so fundamental to our expectations about the world around us that we have a kind of static that builds up when we encounter these things. We don't have a large enough vision of reality. And so we end up in a situation where we have to divide things. We have to say, well, this is alien because it looks like it, and this is human because it looks like it. But that might not be true. For example, one thing that has always haunted me is the fact that there are so many species on planet Earth with different forms. In the case of the caterpillar and the butterfly, obviously profoundly different forms. And I've wondered if it could be that some of these forms that we see are actually human beings, and that would be one of the reasons they're so interested in us. I don't know.
Well, in your book, you do, and this is, I'm assuming these are, you know, trance communications with and on the other side, but talking about are we gods and are gods us? Are we gods to other species who look at this and don't understand, you know, what our forms are?
Yes. Well, exactly. And, because some of these beings seem to be so intimately involved with us that it's hard to believe that they aren't us in some way. Some of the particular ones that came to the cabin in specifically. Now, let's go on, though, because talking to you is like talking to a literal mountain of experience. And I would like to shift gears. And before we do that, though, and we go down another road entirely, Free Dreamlanders, please do what we tell you here. We'll be right back.
One reason to join UnknownCountry.com is the fact that you get Communion, Transformation, The Secret School, Majestic, and Superstorm audiobooks. Another reason, all of the subscriber interviews all the way back to the beginning, and some of them are totally remarkable. All of our contactee interviews that Ann Strieber did, deeply fascinating material. What is it really like to be inside this experience? If you're in it, you can learn more and more. And if you're not, then you can explore more and more. There is so much here. Join UnknownCountry.com today. Which means stop what you're doing, pause the show, go to UnknownCountry.com, join now. Do it. We love you, and we'd really love you if you did it.
We're back. We're talking to John Alexander. His website, johnbalexander.com. His most recent book is Reality Denied. He's also written UFOs. It's a fascinating book about his vision of the UFO phenomenon. No Simple Solutions to This Complex Phenomenon will sum up the book. And it's got a wonderful introduction by Jacques Vallée, Bert Rutan, Tom Clancy also involved in it. So it's quite fascinating stuff, and not the answers you will generally get. Reality Denied is a compendium of experiences that, some of which, to say the least, are rather unusual. Or am I understating that, John? I don't know.
Well, I'm not sure they're as unusual as yours, but yeah, we have visited shamans all over the world, and it does address a broad spectrum. You remember the first, the subtitle is first-hand experiences with things that can't happen, but did.
But did, exactly.
Like remote viewing and psychokinesis and firewalking, et cetera, as well as postmortem communication, NDEs.
So what I would like to do is to go back to the Skinwalker Ranch days, to the part at the beginning of the book about NIDS, because that's evolved a great deal since then. And I'd like you to tell us of your experience of NIDS and at NIDS, at the Skinwalker Ranch, and what do you think about what has evolved there since?
It is a very, very strange place, and in fact, I am just back. Was up there filming, and for those who watched The Secret of Skinwalker Ranch, the third season is on now. To say the place is strange is just such a dramatic understatement. The incidents that happened before, during, and after NIDS, of course, defy explanation. And one of the problems is the breadth of experiences. Everything from UFOs to you know, beings materializing, i.e. the Skinwalker, per se, tunnels, interdimensional communications, things appearing, disappearing, cattle, mutilations, again, them disappearing for a time and reappearing. So it's just, it's almost difficult to explain just how bizarre these sorts of experiences are. The ranch is now owned by Brandon Fugel and is instrumented far more thoroughly than even we did at NIDS. And they are capturing from time to time things that just cannot be explained.
I've never been invited to the ranch. I wish I had been. On the one hand. On the other hand, people like me sometimes get in trouble in places like that. So I'm not absolutely sure that it would be a good idea.
Well, one of the things that has been noted as individuals who have not been there before show up, strange events seem to happen. I can also say that over time, it does appear that certain individuals are more sensitive to these events than others. One of the concerns has been, I don't know what you'd call it, the others, visitors, ones that tag along. One of the questions has been, you know, did you bring something back with you? Some people seem to have had those sorts of experiences where the incidents may be initiated at the ranch but continue at other locations.
Well, you know, I live with someone, or maybe more than one someone, here in this flat. I'm writing a new book, and once again, I'm writing it with someone. I say someone. I think it. I look upon it as something connected to Anne, but I can't identify it as Anne. And she said herself, I'm not Anne anymore, but I'll always be Anne for you. And I wonder if I went there, if what is with me would go, because it goes with me everywhere. In other words, if I go to a hotel, it's definitely involved in my life, the same way as it would be if I was sitting here in this apartment. So I just wonder. I've always been curious about what would happen if I went there.
But what you're describing affects some of the more profound aspects of what you've written about. And it's interesting to me, there's one quote again in your book where Anne is talking singular and then says we, as if multiple entities, and as I say, being outside the body, and the difference between the personality and the soul. And if we understand the interconnectedness of everything, then, you know, do we in fact merge into some uber consciousness at some point and thus lose the personality? And yet, when we're dealing with various mediums, they talk about personality of the individual sometimes as they had lived in this regime. Or does this mean that there's a hierarchical spirit as people move forth in their spiritual evolution?
Now, in their spiritual evolution, but you've talked about orbs before, and I think a lot about orbs, and in fact, a sadly deceased mutual friend of ours, William Mallow of Southwest Research, whom I know you knew from your non-lethal weapons work. In fact, as I recall, you stayed with us in San Antonio with me and Ann one time when you were working with Bill out at Southwest.
Well, actually, I was with the Army Science Board at that time. We were in for a meeting. Do you remember? In Great Barbecue.
Yeah, I do remember Rudy's Barbecue. Anyway, he was energized to interest in this whole subject because of an orb that came into his house. But not all orb experiences have been good. In fact, they're mostly quite neutral, but not necessarily. And you mentioned, and I did not know this, one of the reasons that the family decided to sell the ranch to Bob Bigelow in the first place had to do with an orb. Do you recall that story, the Shermans?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, tell us that story.
Yeah, Terry had told us about that, and it was kind of infamous. And interestingly, again, in the program, there's a nephew of his who's come forward who was there to validate the experience. But it was that they had dogs, of course, and the blue orbs were floating along at a relatively low level, and the dogs were jumping up and nipping at them, and they continued moving to the east, and the dogs followed, and then they disappeared, which had never happened before. There were three dogs, and the next day, Terry found three greasy spots that he assumes were the orbs. The reason that he wanted to sell them was he had teenage boys and was interested that they might also have a negative interaction or not leave the orbs alone and have this kind of retaliation.
What's interesting about this is that there aren't too many other stories about orbs that do things like that. And you just wonder, what is the difference in that area? Because that suggests some kind of a defensive posture. In other words, unless they somehow wanted something that the dogs had and left nothing but a grease spot behind, could they have been predatory orbs with a taste for dog? It's so mysterious, John. Very mysterious. You know, you see the orbs I've seen orbs in the fields in England. I didn't see a crop circle form after that. What years ago, Ann and I, in broad daylight, saw a very bright orb moving around in a field in England, and it didn't do anything, but you know, it disappeared after a while. We didn't feel threatened by it.
That video, and it is quite striking. You do see an orb moving about, and then daylight comes and the fog lifts. You know, there's an aggregate. Did it cause that? Don't know, but there certainly appears to be a relationship. Whether it's a causal relationship or not is hard to say.
I'm going to read a little bit about the ranch from your book. One of the inexplicable stories that lends credence to the Skinwalker Ranch phenomenon happened shortly after the family had first moved in. While on a break working close to the house, Terry noticed a dog approaching from the west. As it walked right up, he realized it was a wolf, not a dog. The wolf was very large, its head coming to the middle of Terry's chest, which would make it three times or four times the size of a normal wolf, by the way. And after petting the animal, it seemed domesticated. He returned to his work. Then he heard a commotion in his cattle pen. He found the wolf had reached under the bottom railing, grabbed a 600-pound calf by the snout, and was attempting to pull it out. He beat it with a wooden post. That didn't help. He fired a .44 Magnum at it at point-blank range, six rounds into the wolf's chest. Didn't do anything. Eventually, the wolf wandered off, but not in any hurry. He fired an an elk rifle at the animal and saw chunks of flesh fly off its body. Eventually, it disappeared from sight. He then went to where he'd seen the flesh fall off. There were remnants of the animal there. They had seemed already putrefied. What do you suppose that was all about? Did you ever get anywhere with stories like that?
Well, no. The other piece of it is it went across the thing and they followed tracks and it just disappears, just literally into thin air. And of course, the idea of something, flesh coming off and be already putrefied. That's the stuff of horror fiction novels.
Yeah. Well, there was a type of wolf that lived in that area during the Ice Age known as the dire wolf.
Right.
And it would have been that size. Maybe the flesh was putrefied because it was actually in another time, that there's some kind of disconnect or mismatch in time streams there. And that was a dire wolf from another time, which wasn't entirely subject to the laws of reality in our time, in the sense that it wasn't fully invested in our time. I wonder. That would explain why once the flesh was left behind in this time, of course it was putrefied because it was thousands of years old.
Yeah. Well, that reminds me of a incident that you talk about in the New World, or a New World, and that is driving long and having a temporal displacement and seeing things that were there at another time.
Oh, yeah.
I had an incident similar to that when I was stationed in Hawaii. I was out at a beach one night, very popular area, was literally running along, and all of a sudden there was a time shift, and it was as if I was in an era that was at least a century before, and then shifted back.
Can you tell us what gave you the impression that you were in an era a century before?
Well, the impression I had was that I had been Hawaiian, that I was that person, albeit a century before, running along, and the beaches were totally undeveloped at that time. It didn't last more than a few seconds, and then shifted back. Now, this is the stuff of, Dark Shadows and Outlander and various TV programs, but, maybe the damn things occur.
Right. Exactly. But they do occur. I've had that happen to me in a number of different ways. A sudden movement back in time in 1983, a movement into a parallel universe with another man's child and the family's child in my car in, I guess, early 1990s. And then more recently, two movements into what appears to be a parallel universe, very much like this one right here in Santa Monica, which were physical events. So this does happen. And in fact, I think the more it happens to you, the kind of looser you get and the more apt it is to happen again. Tell us about some of the experiences, that personal experiences you've had that have really stopped you and that stay with you over the years. Paranormal, of course.
Right.
Does anything come to mind?
One that comes to mind that was very different, I mentioned in the book, when I was a young paratrooper, had really just joined the Army. I was in the 101st Airborne and was in a medical company. But In those days, mess hall was very different. It literally was the mess hall and belonged to the unit, and you had to go outside and come down, and then they had a pull-up bar, so you had to do pull-ups before you went in, you know, three times a day. And normally, you know, you do six or eight. And my upper body strength has never been as strong as my lower body strength, can run for miles and miles and miles. But I was going into dinner one day, and all of a sudden did, you know, I think I stopped at 18 or 20 pull-ups as if I had no physical weight at all, as if there were no physical effort being involved. And it was just strikingly different from, you know, hundreds and hundreds of other times that I did the same exercise.
Well, what you're saying here about something as odd as that takes me to the whole issue of out-of-body experiences and our whole experience of the body, because the body is only part of the body, in effect. In other words, I've been out of my body a numerous times. I'm not able to get out myself, but I am taken out from time to time. I think that, I mean, I know how to get out, but it does not work unless the visitors or whatever they are want me out for some reason, and then they send me on a mission one kind or another. And that's happened four or five times in my life. One of them was to Linda Moulton Howe, who saw me in her bedroom in the middle of the night and became quite upset, as you may imagine. Now, you talk about the Monroe Institute in Reality Denied. You tell us a little bit about this experience.
Well, Bob Monroe was a good friend of ours. Of course, he literally wrote the book called Journeys Out of the Body. Very interesting experience, which has continued since his death. One of the questions that comes up is, what is out of the body, if anything? And there's an interesting tale. As you know, Joe McMonigal was remote viewer 001.
Yeah, we have an interview with him on Dreamland.
I'm sorry?
We have an interview with him on the website, yes.
Yeah. Well, he is also married to Scooter, who is Bob Monroe's daughter. But he told us a story about when he's working out at SRI and doing remote viewing a UFO and saying all of a sudden he becomes aware that they are aware of his presence, you know, and just consciousness being forward. At the Maimonides, there were a number of experiments done where they were trying to determine, you know, where the consciousness was at any given time. And what they did was they had a target set up that was generated in such a way it could only be observed from a certain position, that if you looked at the target from a different direction, you would get, you know, a different sort of thing, and then put in strain gauges and were able to pick up the essence of the individual who was there doing experiments, meaning the consciousness had to be physically located at a specific place. And Bob, of course, talks about being out of the body. He said he was sort of a natural. His comment was that he never, when they put him in, they hadn't included all the pegs that kept the spiritual form and the physical body together. And of course, what his approach was using the development of hemisync, two different frequencies, creating a beat frequency. I found it, you know, frankly appealing to me, having tried meditation for a long time. And in that, you try to find the specific altered state that you want. And his approach as a electrical engineer would say, I'll just drive you there. And so it's much easier to return to someplace once you know how to get there. And that's what they're doing with the various levels that his system offers.
So, you know, in my own experience, I've interacted with people while I was out of my body, and they've seen me. Linda Moultonhow is not the only one. There was a radio announcer in Chicago who asked, I ended up in his bedroom in the middle of the night before the radio show I was going to go on. And on the show, he asked me, so what were you doing in my bedroom in the middle of the night? And I said, I can't explain it. And he said, well, we both saw you. Meaning his wife. And I said, well, I have no way to explain that. And we went on with the show. It's just a couple of minutes. But I was left flabbergasted because I hadn't tried to go into his house. I thought, in fact, I thought it was some kind of a dream until I saw him the next morning. I'd never seen him before. And I realized that he was the man in that dream, that whom I'd been looking at standing beside his bed. So, it, you know, people can be seen in that state. Do you know of any efforts to formalize that really work? In other words, the Monroe Gate experience, the Monroe Institute Gateway, which I have taken, and you have too, is a beautiful experience. But is there anyone who can reliably get out of their body like Bob could during his lifetime?
Short answer is I don't know. But I would remind folks that if you attended the Gateway program, even when Bob was there, he always said, if you're coming to get out of your body, you know, that's the wrong approach. What we are working on is elevating consciousness and the ability to acquire information. Do you need to be out of your body to do that? One of the issues I'm constantly looking at now in the area of creativity, I would suggest that, you know, once an idea has formed and brought to fruition, it is there. And so that's why you have these issues of who invented what, and you see them developing along parallel lines. Does that mean you're getting out of your body? I suggest that that's one aspect, but that what we remember is that, again, if the universe is totally interconnected, that these consciousness, can be ascertained at a distance. That was the question of, you know, where is this consciousness located and does that make a difference? Of course, in NDEs, the otoscopic issue comes up repeatedly, i.e. people were up above their body looking down at it and suddenly recognize, oh, me, as I think of myself, my consciousness self, am up here and down there is a physical body, which I may or may not have any particular relationship to.
Yeah, well, exactly. And in my case, the movements out of the body have been very clean, and they've involved a shock going down the spine that seems to open something, and then I just roll out and engage in whatever activity has been planned for me. And I've traveled more than halfway across the country and to great heights and done all kinds of things, talked with people who remember very well the experience. And so it happens. It's incredible.
Well, it sounds like that's initiated by what would be called a Kundalini experience.
Probably so.
Yeah. It's, but, I'm reminded of a specific near-death case that I have. A friend of mine was a pilot who was shot down in Vietnam and is up out of his body looking down, and he encounters an entity and says, what are you doing here? And he said, well, I need to get help for them. It wasn't, I need to get help for me. And so there was that conscious differentiation between himself in this out-of-body NDE state and his physical body, which had was banged up very badly in the crash.
You know, that's fascinating. I wonder what that may mean, because that phrase, I'm not Anne anymore, but I'll always be Anne for you, comes to mind again. Because are we also someone else, John, do you think?
Well, I think there's an illusion of separateness, and that has driven much of the problems of the earth. And certainly in these international relationships that we constantly find ourselves in. Because I get accused frequently of being a socialist. And because I do think we ought to be helping others and whatnot.
Right. And, yeah. If you have compassion nowadays, you're a socialist. I don't get that either. I'm no socialist, well, but I am compassionate.
I know. But my comment to them is, you know, if you're thinking globally, you're thinking too small.
That's fascinating. Why do you say that?
Because it's universal consciousness, not related to either nationalism, or even global. And I think you've talked to in the books interrelations with other planetary systems as well as interdimensional systems.
Yes. Well, that, you know, that's an entirely different story. In my case, I have had fairly extensive experiences of other worlds that feel, that I think are physically real, but I don't think it's necessary to travel to them in a spaceship. But I wonder what you think about the situation in the world as it stands. We seem to be kind of on a collision course with a very terrible destiny, in the sense that we are going to have major changes, climate changes, that are going to be very inimical to our future. And at the same time, this whole mysterious presence, from the close encounter experience to the developing events at the Skinwalker Ranch, to the government's release of UFO video, this whole mystery seems to be becoming deeper and more concrete, both at the same time. Do you have a kind of overview of where we are? And I know it's a big question. If you want to take a few moments to think about it, please do.
I would suggest that what we're having now is a greater awareness of some of these issues as it applies to some people. I'm reminded, you know, I've done a lot of work in Brazil and working with shamans. And when you deal with shamans, you know, they move seamlessly back and forth. We seem to think of the physical reality and the spiritual world, which in a materialistic thing may or may not exist, but certainly separate and distinct, whereas shamans move seamlessly between them. Now, I mentioned Brazil because I've dealt with very high-level people down there. And it's interesting because their formal education is in institutions that are very Western materialistic organized, and yet they have, you know, belief in spiritual, the spiritist religions and whatnot, and can inculcate that acceptably, which would be quite different from what most Americans would think of it.
Yes. John, we've reached the end of our first hour. Can you continue for another half hour?
Sure.
Oh, good. I'm so glad, because I want to discuss shamans. John has an in-depth knowledge of shamanism that is quite unlike anything you will ever have heard before. And so when we get back, subscribers, this is what we will be discussing. And Free Dreamlanders, as always, thank you so much for being with us on Dreamland.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.